So very quickly, I think in last few months of COVID-19, this really tiny virus, seemingly very insignificant, has given us a lot of lessons. Many of these lessons were things that we knew, but we were trying to shove under the carpet. And I think very important is, no matter what our creed, race, religion, political ideology, social ideology, we all have only one planet to share. We all critically depend on the resources of that planet. We are deeply interconnected to each other and very, very interconnected to all other species on this planet that we share with them. And any impact on any one of the species could impact all of us. Another very deep realization, again, which we knew but were not accepting, is that a lot of the social, political, ecological issues that we are facing currently as humanity, as human society, are very linked to a broken relationship that we have with ourselves, our internal environment, and that of our external environment. And this fact about this broken relationship with our external environment has been very clearly brought out by a very important report that some of you may have seen already, which is a global biodiversity status report that came out in 2019, brought out by Intergovernmental Panel on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services, which said that human activity has significantly altered our environment, so much so that nearly 1 million species are currently threatened with extinction. Not only are the species, human existence itself is gravely threatened. I mean, the report brings out lots of alarming facts, including that we are currently over $577 billion worth of crop production is threatened because of loss or extinction of pollinating species. Or that about 100 to 300 million people are at risk of floods and hurricanes because of loss of coastal habitats. But in addition to that, there is another report that came out a few years ago, which said that 22% of the world's territory is inhabited or controlled by what they call the indigenous peoples. And this 22% contains 80% of world's biodiversity. So this is what brings us to the topic of our conversation this evening, which is, who are these people? What are these territories that we are talking about? And what kind of answers can they give us for the kind of problems that humanity is currently facing? So very quickly, these are the areas, what we call ICCAs, or for the South Asian region, we call them CCAs, or Community Conserved Areas, increasingly being called territory of life, globally referred. So these are territories and areas governed, managed, and conserved by indigenous people and local communities. We find that there are many, many of we find them all across the globe, all across ecosystems and cultures. There are thousands of them, and all of them have different names. Different communities refer to their conserved areas by different names. But globally speaking, if we want to identify and find what the main parameters that we can use to define ICCAs or CCAs, as we'll be referring to them. So basically, any area where there is a community which has deep, strong bond with its territory, whether it is mountain ecosystem, forest, freshwater, coastal, grassland, marine ecosystems, the community has a de facto capacity to take decisions and enforce rules in that territory, even if they don't have legal rights over this territory. And the decisions and rules are positive for conserving nature, as well as for the livelihoods and well-being of the community itself. So as we would say, considering that there is very, I think for people in South Asia, very high human population density. We have four biodiversity hotspots in this region, and many of us would promote these habitats. Biodiversity hotspots are also inhabited by people like Adivasi communities, pastoralist communities, fisher folk, and other traditional ecosystem and communities. But these areas are highly threatened, and mainly threatened because they don't have any legal recognition. Most of them are not, their rights to their territories or the habitats they are governing are not recognized. There is very little information about them. There's a lack of visibility of what is their significance for conservation and well-being. They face serious threats from projects like mines, dams, industrialization projects, urbanization, pollution. Basically, the mainstream economic model of development threatens these communities and their territories. Many of them are facing threats to their life, their community, their property when they are trying to defend their territories against external forces. So in 2010, realizing these threats and realizing what important answers these communities and their territories had for human societies for the future, a group of people and working with such communities in such areas came together to form a global consortium called ICCA Consortium, which was registered in 2010. And since then, it has made significant progress, at least internationally, to try and bring visibility to such community initiatives. The main mission of this ICCA consortium is to promote the appropriate recognition of ICCAs. It's a member-based network which includes organizations and federations of indigenous peoples, local communities, and NGOs working directly with them as its members. And it also has honorary members, which are often committed individuals who want to work or who are supporting ICCAs in their regions. The main focus area of work for ICCA is supporting ICCAs, documentation and mapping of ICCAs, empowering and defending when they are trying to fight against external threats, and enriching them, including by supporting their ecological restoration projects or their governance and management planning processes, livelihood enhancement processes, among others. So the members were South Asia, who are also associated with ICCA Consortium, and many of them who are not directly associated but are working with ICCAs decided to come together to form a collective at South Asia level. This collective is very new, and the objective of this collective is also trying to support ICCAs or communities' efforts at conservation within South Asia region. We try to do that through a number of activities, which includes through outreach, networking, documentation, knowledge generation, livelihood supports, etc. And these are all people who are directly, many of them are directly engaged with these communities on the ground. The second important project, which is a process that we are trying to start very soon, which is an integrated map-based portal, to document ICCAs in this region, where communities and organizations can share, exchange, validate, and publish information on their ICCAs. There will be a link shared in the chat box of this map. Any of you interested can go and check it out on our website. So one of the objectives of this collective is also, as I said, bringing about visibility to these ICCAs, the very significant work that these communities are doing. So we thought of starting this webinar series where we will be covering stories from Nepal, India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Maldives, hopefully. And we hope to cover all ecosystems, wetlands, grasslands, high altitude mountains, forests, marine and coastal areas, essentially to create a dialogue about alternative ways of ecological and human well-being. Any of you associated with these efforts, as Tanya already mentioned in the beginning. Hello? Hello?
Yes, Neema, I can hear you.
Oh, okay. So as Tanya already mentioned in the beginning, that we have an email list for CCA South Asia where we share information with each other. If you would like to become a member or honorary member of the consortium, or you know of communities who should become members of the consortium, or if you would like to share, suggest communities that that are engaged in conservation and should be part of this ICCA portal that we just spoke about, or should be called for these webinar talks, please contact us at ICCASouthAsia@gmail.com. So as I said, as part of this webinar series, we thought of covering all ecosystems. And first of the ecosystems that we are talking about are really lesser known ecosystem, the wetlands and the community's efforts towards restoration and regenerating these wetlands. Just to give a very quick synopsis, we have in India, 4.6% of India's geographical area is covered by wetlands, which supports 20% of our known biodiversity. These are mainly classified into four groups, Himalayan wetlands, Indo-Gangetic wetlands, coastal wetlands, and Deccan wetlands. And there are community conservation efforts because of their social, socio-cultural, religious, and livelihood-related association with these wetlands in almost all of these different kinds of wetlands. So here we would like to share with them, with you all, what their stories are, what kind of constraints do they face, what kind of hurdles have they overcome in doing what they are doing, what role have women and other disprivileged sections of society have played in these initiatives, and what lessons do they have for wetland conservation policies in general and dealing with crises like climate change and pandemic like COVID-19. So I wouldn't take any more of your time. Thank you very much. I would invite Manish and Shalu. We are very happy to have you here, Manish and Shalu. And please share with us the story from Gondia. Thank you.
We both are here, myself, Manish, and my co-worker, Shalu. She is also here. So today, now we are going to talk about the wetland conservation work that is going on in Bhandara and Gondia districts of Maharashtra. Tanya, can you please share the slides? Just go for the next slide.
Yes.
Bhandara and Gondia are situated in the Vidarbha region of Maharashtra and on the easternmost border of Maharashtra, adjoining with Chhattisgarh and Madhya Pradesh, which is the part of the central Gondwana region. Next slide, Tanya. Both these districts are known as the lake districts of Maharashtra due to the existence of large number of traditional tanks in these two districts. Am I audible properly? Tanya, Nima? Okay. So, there were around 12,000 traditional tanks in 1901. In both of two districts, and today it came to around 2,700 in these two districts. During our presentation, we will go in details why this thing is happening to these tanks. But traditionally, these tanks were built for the purpose of protective irrigation of rice crop, because rice was the traditionally main crop of this area. So irrigation is the purpose for which these tanks were built. But when a certain tank exists or a wetland exists in any village or vicinity of the village, people start using it for different types of purposes. So after irrigation, fishery is the second largest use for which these traditional tanks are being used. Please go ahead, Tanya. Then there are many resources which these wetlands are providing to the communities. It means a tank not only provides irrigation to the people getting water from it, but many wetland resources are useful for the community for their sustenance in different ways. So one of major contributing resource is the rhizomes of Nelumbo nucifera. And people used to collect it for 3 to 4 hours in the early morning period in summer season, that is in April and May. And always women used to do this collection work, and after it they sell it in local market or a trader comes to their village. And surprisingly, even before this MGNREGA providing 232 rupees of wages, these people were getting around 250 to 300 rupees per person per day from extraction and selling of these rhizomes from the tanks available in their villages. Then fodder for livestock is also another use for which these tanks were used traditionally. Large number of livestock is dependent on it because only green fodder or what we call wet biomass is available in summer is only in the tanks around the village. Please go ahead next. As I have said, though these were major uses, but we have documented what types of uses people are doing of these wetlands. And we have, though we, in total, we have documented around 26 uses of wetlands. And each wetland is used for almost 12 to 15 uses. And only irrigation is the consumptive use of water, and all other uses of wetlands are non-consumptive uses of water. And if we go in detail of this analysis, what we have found that only the beneficiary families, only 15 to 20% of them are associated in the agriculture or irrigation from the tank. And 85% of families who are dependent on these wetlands are other than irrigation purpose or non-consumptive uses. Please go ahead. It is an interesting photograph of a wetland. You might be, here are some grasses which are near to the camera lenses. Those are vetiveria, and after that the yellow patch which is seen in the photograph is the wild rice found in these tanks. And after that, before the water water spread, there is a blackish green belt which is another half submerged type of grass, Iliocaris dulcis. All these plants play significant role in controlling the siltation, and it is the natural system of the vegetation to control the silt which is coming with the flowing water from the catchment of the tank. And people in the, our area knows very well about this role of the plant, and so the extraction of khas grass, that is vetiveria, they have the systems of extracting khas, how it can be extracted, that the water should not come directly in the wetland with the silt. They have those practices. Next slide. Then after independence, these earlier these tanks were built during reign of Gond kings around 200 to 300 years ago, and after independence these have been taken over by the state department, and at that time they have done many changes in this system. So first of all, they have in the name of technological changes, they have changed the sluice gates of these tanks. Earlier, it has to be a step-like structure to release water from tank to canal. And in that place, they have placed those metal gates. Then they have increased the heights of the waste wear to increase the water holding capacity of the tanks. And fishery department then introduced blue revolution to increase the fish production of these tanks. And for increasing this fish production, they have introduced some outside species. Some of them are from Gangetic Plains, those known as the IMCs, Indian Major Carps, Rohu, Katla and Regal. And some from China also, exotic fishes like grass carp and common carp. They have also been introduced in these tanks to increase the fish production. Then Green Revolution was also introduced to increase the production in agriculture field. And with Green Revolution, there came the use of pesticides and fertilizers in more and more amount. And as many tanks have agriculture fields in their catchment area, these chemical residues used to come to these tanks and then again further impact on the plants and birds and fishes diversity and low level of production in the tanks. This Blue Revolution has also created another problem that all the introduced these new species are herbivores, and mostly the indigenous species are carnivores or omnivores. So the these new species which were released by the Fishery Department of Maharashtra, they said that it will give you more production to the fisherman community, and they have seen that in a year that fish grew about 2 and 2.5 kg in a year, because these tanks were traditional and the food chain in these tanks were intact. So people also believed them that yes, these new species are giving more production than our local one. So they have started hearing what the advices the department is giving to them, and the department also told them that your local fishes are the enemies of these new species, because when you are releasing the seeds in these tanks, they used to consume it and your production is going down. So you have to eradicate these indigenous species. So people did this in many tanks. Then fishing method for these newly introduced species was also different. Dragnet has to be used to catch these fishes, and when the fishermen, fisher folks are using the dragnet, the aquatic vegetation that became as the problem in dragging the net. The fishery department declared all the aquatic vegetation as weed, and they have introduced grass carp to as a scavenger species to eradicate these plants from the tanks, because they have that picture in mind of aquaculture. Means fishery department is promoting all the principles of aquaculture in these water bodies which are part of the natural channels in these villages. And that is still a very big dilemma of fishermen. So what the community is doing, that is capture fishery, and what department is promoting is aquaculture. So every time the department used to call this community lazy, as they are not producing as much fishes from these tanks as in aquaculture tanks are providing 1.5 ton to 2 tons of production per hectare, and these things merely goes up to 400 to 500 kgs on an average per hectare production, and that is also on paper due to contribution from the large dams and all that. In reality, what we have seen in last some years, that the per hectare fish production of these tanks is almost low to 20 to 30 kgs per hectare. And this is a very big setback to the community, which is dependent on fishery for their livelihood. And all these different changes have impacted on the biodiversity of the wetlands and the communities dependent on wetlands for other than irrigation use. And then the government has also done one thing that though earlier people used to manage these tanks and there used to be committee of beneficiaries of these tanks in a village, and they used to take decisions on when to clear the path of water from catchment to the tank, or when to desilt the tank and take that silt as a fertilizer in their agricultural fields, or any decision related to the tank. And people used to think it holistically from catchment to the last use of water or the last use of the wetland. But after the government came in picture, there are different departments working in the same tank. If a catchment is there and forest is in the catchment of a water body, it goes to forest department. And the tank is in revenue land, then it comes to revenue department. Then if the fish production has to be done in that tank, it goes to the fishery department. If the water of the tank is used for agriculture purpose or irrigation, it goes to agriculture department. And the tank is with irrigation department or the Zilla Parishad minor irrigation department. So all these different types of government level stakeholders are there, and they don't have anything to do with each other's program, or they all have their different portfolios and they never sit together and coordinate with each other on what to do in these tanks and how it should be done, that the benefits people are getting from generations should be carried forward to the next generation. The government is managing all the water resources only for three purposes, only for water for irrigation, water for domestic purpose, and water for industrial use. Whereas communities are using these water bodies for 27 different types of uses, and all these uses are never in account of government, who is managing and developing these water resources. Next slide, Tanya. So just I have described, this is one type of structure. It is a wastewater of a tank where excess water flows down from this wall and then goes in the natural channel which is connected to the water body. When the irrigation department started constructing these walls, they have never thought of fish migration or fishes coming through the natural water channels to these tanks. And all the natural stocking which was going on earlier has stopped due to these structures. And now the fishing cooperative society has to depend only on the seed of these introduced species from the market, which is outside of their control. Next slide. Then while introducing these seeds of IMCs, there are some unwanted guests who came with these seeds of introduced fishes. One such is epizootic ulcerative syndrome, which is known as EUS. It is a bacterial and contagious disease. It increases during the winter season. It is basically a bacterial infection, and it has very high mortality rate due to this disease. And most of the fish production is declined from when this disease is found in this area. So before 30 to 35, 40 years, when these seeds were introduced, before that, this disease was never found in any tank in this area. So definitely this disease came with these IMCs. And the fishery department, it is basically related to the pH level of water. So fishery department have told the community to use lime to increase the pH. And the amount of lime, if you are using it in summer, then you have to use 2 quintals per hectare. And if a disease is found in the tank, and then as a medication you have to use the lime, it has to be 6 quintals per hectare. So after depositing so much amount of lime in the water body, not a single grass can be found in your tank. So even if the fishes are survived from this disease, they will not get anything to eat and they will die of starvation. So it is so people are very reluctant to listen on using the lime, and they have started exploring different another things for controlling this disease. Then another is this Anabas testudinus. This fish is very, very devastating. It survives for three days out of water. It can walk on ground, it can climb on tree, and even dogs are stray dogs in villages. They are also not going to eat this fish because she has her fins have are very sharp, and there are thorns on her tail, on her fins, even on her mouth. So nobody in natural condition, there is no any predator for this fish. And she is in all the freshwater sources of Maharashtra and throughout India. This fish is growing very fast. Please, next slide, Tanya. So after all these things, the major concern for the community, but that after working for a day in a tank for fishing, they merely get just 5 to 10 kgs of catch, and almost 20 to 30 people are engaged in the fishing activity on that day. So the 5 to 10 rupees per person for working for a day in a tank for fishing. So how they are going to survive in this condition? And that was the major concern for the community, to think on what they are doing, what government is promoting, what different departmental policies are impacting on our tank. And the some of the persons from community started thinking on it, that we have to do something, but they were not very sure about what to do. So we have started talking with them. Next slide, Tanya. This is Patiram Tumsare, and there are people, many people like him in the fishing community, which is known as Dhiwar. And it is a traditional fishing community in our area, in Vidarbha region. And he is a very highly knowledgeable person. He is a great thinker. He is a researcher and the barefoot ecologist. He is not only expert of botany, he is expert of zoology, he is expert of ornithology and entomology, and all he also knows what the interlinkages are there. If a certain plant abundance is going down in tank, how it will going to impact on certain fish species or certain bird species. He knows, he has that kind of knowledge about the interlinkages of resources found in wetland. So there are many people like him in the community with whom we started talking, and they have told us that we have to do basically three things. One is to, we have to restore the tanks, because after the, so much devastation and all these so-called development or production development by the department, the community started rethinking of all these things, and they realized that we have to restore the tanks, and for that purpose we have to restore the plants diversity in the tank, and plantation should be done in this regard to restore the tanks. Then another objective was to conserve the indigenous fish species, because for they thought that for sustainability of livelihood and on fishery, they have to go back to their indigenous species rather than these high yielding introduced species, because the indigenous species have high nutritional value, high protein value, and they have higher economical returns also. But due to this rise, the dream of rise in production, they went behind all the driving forces for some time. But now realize that they have to come back to their originals for sustainability of their livelihood dependent on fishery. Tanya, next slide. So after we have decided to work on this, we started documenting things. We have taken the help of some of the botanists from the local colleges in our area, and we have documented what is remained in the tank. At the same time, we have also communicated with the community and documented what was already gone and what were the reasons that those plants were not found today in these tanks. And after this documentation, Tanya, next slide. All these are traditional tanks. So though they are with the irrigation department or ZP minor irrigation department, no department has any map of catchment or what is the catchment of a certain traditional tank. Nobody knows about it. So we have done the mapping, GPS mapping with the community on about the land use pattern in the catchment. We tried to see from this mapping exercise that if the land use pattern of the catchment has any correlation with the diversity exists in the tank. If the forest area cover or the agricultural area or human habitation, what has is there any correlation with the biodiversity found in the tank? Till now we have not found any such relationship between it, and mostly the floral diversity and the birds and fish diversity is basically dependent on the flora diversity in the tank, and the flora diversity is very much sensitive to the soil type and soil nutrition in the tank. So land use pattern in catchment is not very much affecting or related to the biodiversity found in the tanks. We have done this exercise in around 15 tanks and mapped the catchments of 15 tanks and tried to see and establish this relationship. Please go ahead. Then after documentation, we have, as the community people have told us, that we have to restore the tank. For that, we need to do the plantation. And we again went back to our resource persons from Botany that though you have told that these things are existing, these are gone, and these are surviving in on periphery or in half submerged area or fully submerged plants, some of floating plants, they have documented all the diversity that is existing. We asked them that now we have to do the plantation of some of the selected species, which are the key species for the habitat of fishes and birds in this area. And for improving the fish production of the tank, we have to do the plantation of these species. So what should be done? How we should move away? They told us that, see, we will give you the identification, which plant is this, what chemical properties does it contain and all that. But we can't tell you how to plant them in the tank. So we again came back to our community people, again started and discussion with them. And we thought that we should try experiment in a tank. And we have finalized a method and did accordingly. So first of all, we have plowed the tank bed in summer, where in rainy season, after rains, this area comes under water. Please go ahead, Tanya. And the species which were selected for the plantation for developing the aquatic habitat, those were brought from the nearby tanks where plant diversity is good. And with some of the plants which have roots, they are uprooted from those tanks and brought in these tank where we need to do the plantation. Please go ahead. And then when the area where we have done the plowing activity in summer, after rain started and about 1 to 2 feet water comes to that area, this plantation activity has been carried out in these tanks. And very interestingly, we have got a it gave us a learning from our first experience that firstly, all the main members of the fishing cooperative society or the self-help group with whom we have done this experiment, they came for the plantation. And firstly, they started complaining about backaches and all those things. And later, we have when we have followed up, we have got the feedback from women of the village that though you have done plantation and given wages to them, it has not came to our house. It has gone to the liquor shop or other things which were not important to us. So after that, we resolved for ourselves that all the plantation activity will be carried out by women only after this incident. And after that, in each and every tank, though women are not legal shareholders of these fishing cooperative society, we have told the fishing cooperative society that if you have to revive your tank, you have to involve women in wherever we are telling that this activity should be carried out by women, and all the plantation activities after that carried out by women only. Next, Tanya. It is one of the tank which is known as Shringarban. Shringar means makeup. And the tank was famous for its beauty from ages. Earlier, the saras was also used to nest in these tanks. But accidentally, before 4 to 5 years, that pair has died, and after the tank is also started deteriorating due to invasive plant species. So the and bird diversity of this tank has also gone down. In our area, this tank is very famous for the birds diversity, and the fish production of this tank was also good. The taste of the fish was also good. There was demand for the fish from this tank in the local market area. And after the invasion of these some of the plants in the tank, the fish diversity has also gone down. The fish production has also lowered, and the taste it also affected on the taste and body coloration of the fishes and all that. So before 3 years we have did plantation in this tank, and it reformed completely only in 8 months. And these two pictures are taken during the period of 8 months. So here first one is the tank with no vegetation, and after 8 months it almost transformed into this glory for which this tank was famous for. Next. And we have did this aquatic habitat restoration activity in almost 11 tanks in last 6 years. And these are the results of the aquatic vegetation activity. The fish production of the mainly the indigenous fish species has almost doubled. And in some tanks it increased up to 10 to 12 times than the earlier production which was going in the tank. And there are some tanks where this activity was not successful, because we have documented that also why it has failed in those tanks. So one of the reason was the soil type in the tank bed, and another reason is community has not taken good care after plantation. For next 2 to 3 months it the tank has to be guarded after the plantation, and the livestock should not enter the water, because due to their movement the planted plants will get uprooted. So it has to be protected for 2 to 3 months till the planted plants should get rooted in the soil. So these are some of the reasons that due to which the plantation activity has failed. In one of the tank there is a notorious tilapia which is introduced by the fishery department for again production for increasing the production. And this tilapia is also a voracious eater. It is omnivorous, it eats small fishes and aquatic plants also. So wherever the tilapia is found, no plantation or no diversity will survive in that tank. So one of the tank has almost zero result due to the availability of tilapia in that tank. Tanya, next. So till now we are working with about 12 fishing cooperative societies who have around 43 villages in their jurisdiction and 63 wetlands. Out of them 32 are perennial water bodies and 31 are non-perennial. And we have documented 59 indigenous fish species. Even the department guys also don't know that how much fish diversity is available in the tanks in our districts or in our region. Please next slide. We also have documented 161 types of plant species in these wetlands. almost 27 types are grasses. Then there are peripheral plant diversity, then half submerged plants, fully submerged plants, or floating plants. All these are covered in this diversity of 161. Please, next slide. So now I request Shalu to carry on from here, and she is sharing her experiences in Hindi.
So Shalu will be speaking in Hindi. If anybody requires a translation, please let us know in the chat box. Namaste, Shalu.
Namaste.
Hindi.
Namaste, Shalu Kulle. जिस जगह से ये फोटो है और ये अगले एक साल यानी समाधान किया था हमने बचत महिला बचत गट और सोसाइटी के कुछ महिला और पुरुष भी थे और मासेमारी समाज के कोई कुछ महिला भी थे तो हमने समाधान करके सदाफुली निकाली थी उस जगह से। उस जगह में आपको फोटो में दिख रही है कि एक जगह में इतनी बेसम है कि कुछ दिखाई नहीं दे रहा और एक तरफ से देखो तो वहां से खत्म हो गया और वहां महिला खड़े तो उस महिला ने निकला है वो सदाफुली बेसम और अगले यानी दो साल के बाद वहां देखो कि इतने प्लांट्स है कि गिनती भी नहीं कर सकते हम। पूरे
सो यस गो अहेड तानिया नेक्स्ट स्लाइड। या I will just explain this side slide. Tanya, please, can you please go back? Yeah, as Shalu was telling that women from five villages have did Shramdan to extract Ipomoea from these tanks because Ipomoea is also one of the major threat to the diversity and one of the reason for the low fish production. So, and it is known as Beshram in our local language. Beshram means shameless. So, this plant used to flourish in any condition, any situation in the water body. And even if you throw a single stick, it will get shoots from it after rains in the next season. So we have marked the plot of 10 by 10 meters by GPS in these five tanks where all these women have done Shramdan to eradicate the Ipomoea. And it is it was the hypothesis that it cannot be eradicated. Even though you will remove it, it again comes next year. We want to explore that is it true or not, or can it be eradicated. So in these five tanks, as you see, in 2017, from where the Ipomoea was extracted, we have not done aquatic plantation in these tanks. And by natural succession, in the Bhiukidki Talav, 10 indigenous plant species have came in the in that area. Then into just in 2018 there was 24 species. Then the next column is of the individual plants in that plot. We have counted each and every single grass also. Last one is the proportion of Ipomoea regeneration in that removed area. So we have found that after removing the Ipomoea, in 1 year it regenerates of around 1% to 3.5%, and on second year it again comes down if we eradicate, remove it again. And if we continuously remove it for 3 years, it can be eradicated totally. And basically we have collected this data to for strengthening our advocacy point for including this work under MGNREGA, because as eradication of hypomia is not included in the rate list of MGNREGA, though people are facing problems due to it, it cannot be removed through MGNREGA. So from last 2 years we are advocating with district collectorate and the labor commissioner to include this in MGNREGA, so the gram panchayat themselves can add this thing in their plan and implement, and it will help almost all the water bodies throughout the country if these things this thing is included in the MGNREGA. Tanya, next slide.
हमने महिलाओं के महिला ग्राम सभा में ऐसा निर्णय लिया था कि जो रोजगारमी का काम है वो मशीन के द्वारा करते थे, तो हमने ये सोचा कि 51% लोग तो गांव में मजदूर है लेकिन वो मजदूर से ना करे और मशीन से ना करे, वो मजदूर के हाथ से हो, इसलिए हमने महिला ग्राम सभा में ऐसा ठहराव लिया कि वो मजदूर के हाथ से वो काम करे रोजगारमी का, इसलिए हमने कुछ पोस्टर पुस्तक और मजदूर संगठन ऐसे तैयार किए कि वो मशीन के द्वारा काम हो रहा था तालाब खोलीकरण का, वो रुक गया, अभी वो मजदूर के मजदूर से हाथ से भी हो रहा है अभी।
नेक्स्ट स्लाइड कन्या।
ऐसा भी मुल्की मच्छों का कुछ हमारे यहाँ मुल्की मच्छों का कुछ ये नहीं हो रहा था, यानी सिर्फ बंगाली भी मासे थे, तो हमने ये किया कि स्कूल के कुछ बच्चे, गांव के फिशरी कमेटी के कुछ सभासद, महिला बचतगट और हम गांव में जाकर मच्छे चरण दिन का कार्यक्रम किया और मुल्की मच्छे बचाओ ऐसा कुछ प्रभात फेरी भी निकाले गांव के बचतगट की महिला, स्कूल के बच्चे, सहकारी संस्था के सभासद, ऐसे पूरे गांव में घुमाकर मछली बचाओ, मुल्की मछली बचाओ ऐसा प्रभात फेरी भी निकाला था हमने। और उसके उसके बाद तालाब के पानी तालाब जाकर बैठे और उस मछलियों का क्या करना चाहिए, थोड़ी सी चर्चा भी हो गई कि किस लिए बचाना चाहिए और क्यों बचाना चाहिए, ऐसे लोगों को भी बताया कि मुल्की मच्छों का आहार भी खाने के लिए बहुत अच्छी है और पोषण भी हमको मिलता है, ऐसी भी चर्चा हुई थी। और ये अकरा सोसाइटी के सब लोगों ने ऐसा किया, हर साल अपने अपनी जगह में हर सोसाइटी के लोग चरण दिन मनाते हैं अभी, और सब अकरा भी संस्थाओं में अभी चरण पकड़ना बंद है, अभी कोई पकड़ता नहीं, पकड़ने के बाद अगर किसी ने पकड़ा तो उसमें दंड रहता है कि जिस सभासद ने क्यों गांव के लोगों ने पकड़ा तो उसको भरपाई करना पड़ता है कि तुमने क्यों पकड़ा, इसलिए अभी चरण पकड़ने का काम रुक गया है। और अभी ऐसा लगता है हमको कि यानी हमको नहीं लोग मासेमार समाज को कि मुल्की मच्छे ही बचाना चाहिए, बंगाली भारतीय मछली नहीं लाना चाहिए क्योंकि वो खाने के लिए भी अच्छा है और हमको मतलब खाने को नहीं तो अच्छा है लेकिन पोषण बहुत है, आरोग्य को के ऊपर भी कुछ मछलियों का उपाय करते हैं, सर्दी खांसी हो जाती तो बारीक मच्छियों की सब्जी बनाकर उसका थोड़ा सा रसा रहता है वो भी पी लेते हैं तो सर्दी खांसी भी बच जाती है।
नेक्स्ट स्लाइड तानिया।
अभी कोरोना को ध्यान में रखते हुए कुछ सभासदों ने कुछ संस्था के लोगों ने ये निर्णय लिया कि मार्केट में जा भी नहीं सकते और इतना पैसा नहीं है कि कुछ सब्जियां खरीद कर खा सकते हैं, इसलिए सोसाइटी के लोगों ने ये निर्णय लिया कि हमारी तालाब से मछली निकालेंगे वो भी मुल्की और सभासदों को खाने के लिए वाटअप कर लेंगे, तो तो वैसे भी सहार सोसाइटी के लोगों ने वैसा ही किया कि मुल्की मच्छा मछलियां पकड़ के लाते थे तालाब से और सभा सदों में बांट देते थे और शाम को उसकी सब्जी बनाकर खाते थे इसलिए, और थोड़े से भी बेचती भी दे देते थे इसलिए उसको पैसा भी मिला और खाने के लिए सब्जी भी यानी मछली भी मिली। नेक्स्ट दीदी,
नेक्स्ट स्लाइड।
हमने बारा सोसाइटी में ये किया कि बारा तालाब रहेंगे, वहाँ सिर्फ मुल्की मच्छे का भी मुल्की मच्छे भी रहेंगे, बंगाली मछलियों का वहाँ उत्पन्न नहीं किया जाएगा। तो ऐसे 11 तालाब है कि वहाँ सिर्फ मुल्की मच्छे का मुल्की मच्छे ही रहती है। तो अभी ऐसा लगता है कि मुल्की मच्छे क्यों बचाना चाहिए, तो लोगों ने ये निर्णय किया कि हम कोशिश तो करके देखेंगे कि क्या होता है। तो उसका उत्पन्न भी ज्यादा आता है और मार्केट में उसकी डिमांड रहती है, इसलिए 11 तालाब में मुल्की मच्छे का ही उत्पन्न किया जा रहा है। हाँ, और हमने ऐसा भी किया कि कुछ तालाब में अभी मनीष भाई ने बताया कि कुछ तालाब में हमने प्लांट भी लगाया है, इसलिए कई तालाब में कुछ भी वनस्पति नहीं है। तो हमने अभी कुछ एक बचत गट है, एक बचत गट में वो तालाब में जाएंगी और कुछ बीजाई वनस्पति की कुछ बीजाई गोड़ा करेंगी, इसलिए हमने एक सीड बैंक भी तैयार किया है। तो अभी बाहर से खाद्य लाना नहीं, बीजाई लाना नहीं पड़ेगा, हम खुद ही वो करेंगे कि देवधानी खस है इसकी बीजाई गोड़ा करेंगे और बाद में दूसरे तालाब में वो लगाएंगे।
And as I have said, the production was also increased in these tanks, and not only of the indigenous species, even the production of these introduced IMC, Rohu Katla and Mrigal, it has also increased because as the habitat it is restored, the food availability of these fishes was also increased in those tanks, and the production of those fishes is also increased. So after just putting in seeds for last 40 to 45 years and getting production, the fish yield was very low, and the growth of fish was almost came down to 200 grams to 300 grams. But after this habitat restoration activity, now that IMCs are also started growing in these tanks, and they are getting of almost 1 kg of IMC fishes from these tanks also. So thank you everyone, and Tanya.
Thank you, Manish and Shalu, for this lovely presentation. So we have a lot of questions which have come in. I'll ask the participants to ask the questions themselves. So the first question is from Meenal. Meenal, could you unmute yourself and ask your question, please?
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes.
Manish Bhau और शालू जी, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, आपने बहुत ही अच्छा आपके अनुभवों के बारे में हमको बताया। मेरा प्रश्न है कि मनीष भाऊ, आपने इन वाटर बॉडीज को टैंक्स कहा है, तो क्या ये मनुष्य ने बनाए हैं या नैसर्गिक है, और अगर मनुष्य ने बनाए हैं तो कब बनाए हैं ये, और किन्होंने बनाए, और फिर इनकी ओनरशिप कैसे रही है, मतलब इवॉल्व कैसे हुई है उनकी ओनरशिप। थैंक यू।
Shall I reply after each question, Tani?
Yes, please. You can answer.
The tank construction started in late 17th century during the reign of Gond kings, and each tank has different means. You cannot say that all tanks came in existence during same period. Some are 100 years old, some are 150 years, 200 years, and every tank has its own story. In past, there was a community called Koholi that was master in tank building, and they have oral history told by the Koholi community that they were brought from Banaras by the Gond kings in this area for building tanks, as one of the Gond kings have gone on pilgrimage to Banaras, and he saw that they are expert in the water management by using the technique of tank building. He invited them to his area, and they have also came to this area and started building tanks. And later on, many other local communities who were engaged in agriculture, they also have started building tanks. And according to the gazetteer of 1901 of Central Provinces and Berar, there were average 9 tanks in per village in this area. Now it has gone down drastically, but still you can find 2 to 3 tanks in each village of different size. People used to differentiate between different types. The bigger tanks are called bandh, as you have been heard about Navega Bandh or Shiregaon Bandh. Those are big in size, so big tanks are called bandh. Then the next category is talab, or if it is found nearby village, it is called gav talab. Then after that came bodi. It is a small structure, and there can be more than one bodies in the command area of a gav talab. And after bodi came the kutan. Kutan is also a water harvesting structure which is used for minimizing the pressure of water coming from the bigger tank. And as the field channels were constructed in their earthen works, if the pressurized water came to these channels, it will destroy the field channels. So the water from bigger tank is released in this kutan. It will the pressure is minimized, and then after that it will be released in the field channels. So that was kutan, and the last one was do. In rice field, in local language we call them bandi. All the bandis are not on a same height. There is a slight slope. So the bandi which is on the downstream at the lower slope, that is called do. And the excess water in rice field, you have to release excess water for 3 times. That excess water is stored in this do. And if the rains are not proper and you have to irrigate the rice field again, then manually it can be lifted from do to the upper field. So these were 5 types. And regarding the tenure of these tanks, now these are with the ZP minor irrigation department or the Maharashtra state irrigation departments, and in villages the work which we have done, we have though the fisherman community was concerned about the deteriorating condition of tanks and wanted to revive it, we have used the provision of Biodiversity Act and the biodiversity management committees formed under this act in the villages. All these reserve tanks, as Shalu said, that people has reserved fuel tanks for biodiversity conservation, those were resolved by the fishing cooperative society. Then they have submitted that resolution to biodiversity management committee, and biodiversity management committees then resolved to keep those tanks reserved for indigenous fish production and maintaining biodiversity. Then again the ban on reverse migration of fishes was also came in existence through the resolutions of biodiversity management committees. And traditionally there were nistar rights. Nistar rights are the rights which community gets through the provision of the earlier there was this area was in the central provinces, CP and Berar. And the Central Provinces Land Revenue Code has this provision of Nistar, where community rights over common property resources are being documented in the revenue documents. That is called Nistar Patra. And after Maharashtra came in existence and this area was transferred from Central Provinces to Maharashtra, the Maharashtra Land Revenue Code has also carried forward the provision of Nistar rights. So the Nistar rights are also there, and people have recorded rights on these tanks. But surprisingly, only rights of irrigation or for washing clothes or for drinking water of livestock, only these three types of rights were recorded in the Nistar Patrak of every village. And surprisingly, the 27 uses for which the different communities who have low land holding or very minimal or mostly the fishermen community are landless, the right of fishing is also not included in these Nistar documents. Might be that happened due to the feudal system which was in existence during Gond reign and after Britishers. So naturally the person who have came to village for recording the rights have gone through gone directly to the Malguzar or Patel of the village, and at one place he might have documented all the rights for on tanks. So only the irrigation rights and these one two other rights were recorded, but other uses were not recorded as rights. So currently we are also trying to claim the rights over these wetlands by using Forest Right Act, and the work is still going on. We are still struggling to use FRA in for establishing rights over these water bodies.
Thank you, Manish. The next question is from Amol. If he's here, could you please ask your question?
Yeah. Manish and Shalu, thank you very much for a very enriching presentation. Bhandara and Gondia district have a large amount of tanks, as you said. And the tanks you used as examples are mostly located near villages, human settlements. But there are also lots of tanks under the management of the forest department or irrigation or fisheries department. which are not near, they are located quite far away from human settlements. So is it the same story of irresponsible management and devastating biodiversity in those places also, which are not near human settlements?
Surprisingly, yes. The same story of each and every tank. 3 years, before 3 years, we have did this plantation activity in the core area of Nagzira Wildlife Sanctuary with the help of Wildlife Department. The tank in the core of the sanctuary was also got deteriorated due to desiltation activity done by some DFO of that sanctuary. Even we have done the plantation activity in Navegao Band tank also with help of Forest Department. So irrespective of where this tank locates, the condition is same. Because when a fishing cooperative is formed, it had its jurisdiction of 5 square kilometer area. So every village and every tank falling in that 5 square kilometer area belong to this fishing cooperative society, and almost each and every tank which is existing on revenue land are used for fishery. Even some of the tanks, though they were falling under forest, but the tanks were according to government department, though they were on revenue land, so they were also used for fishing, and all the devastating style of fishing and other things also hampered the loss of diversity in those tanks also. But still, there are very few tanks where biodiversity remained intact, and Navegao Band is one of them, because though it is also facing some of the major problems due to Iconia and overgrowth of some invasive plant species, but still that tank has relatively large diversity still existing in it.
Thank you very much.
The next question is from Kamal. Kamal,
good evening. I'm Kamal from Nepal. I first of all, I want to salute to the local ecologists. They are more knowledgeable, and it is I think is a property for the society. My question is very simple. Thank you for Manish. You said you have this wild rice species. Do you have still, or they are already gone? So you said this, the fish species, they transmit the bacterial disease to other. Is it the tilapia or any other things? And you said, is the indigenous fish species. Do you have the indigenous community around these, the wetland area? Do they have the customary system or customary law? And you said you are struggling with the, to get the right. Maybe we can work together with you, and NEMA, ICC is there. We can bring the issues in this Ramsar or maybe in CBD. We have a similar issue. I'm doing the case study on the wetland area in Himalaya and Mijil area. Most of the wetlands are sacred for some community. Mostly I do work on these indigenous peoples and their right. Maybe we can talk with the NEMA in ICCA in later. We can how we can go and work in such a community you have in Maharashtra. Thank you very much.
Tanya, can you please repeat the question, because the voice was low and I was not able to hear properly what he had asked.
There were a few questions. The first one is, how is the area of the wetland? How many communities depend on it? And do you still have wild rice? And then, I mean, if you can answer this, and then we can maybe repeat the other questions.
Just repeat once again.
Kamal, would you like to repeat your question?
Do you have still the wild rice in the wetland area? That was my first question. If you have already, then how can we restore again?
And do you still have wild rice? Sorry, Manish, the first question is, do you still have wild rice? And if not, then how did you restore it?
Wild rice is still there. And in wild rice also, naturally, we have found two varieties of wild rice in our tanks. And as Shalu have told, that just from last year, we have started a seed bank of aquatic plant species, which are the plants, the propagation of plants, which is possible through seeds. We have started collecting seeds of those plants, and the seeds of both of the varieties of wild rice is also there.
Kamal, what was your next question, please?
Next question is the tilapia that can transmit bacterial disease. Is it right or?
Not very sure that it came through tilapia only. But before introduction of tilapia, IMCs were introduced. And the disease is found in this area after the introduction of IMCs. So it is just an observation that it might have came through the seeds of IMCs.
Kamal, did you have any other questions?
Is the wetland, is there any indigenous peoples surrounding in the wetland area, and they are also in part of the society? If so, do they have some customary system or customary law to use the wetland ecosystem?
Yes, actually mixed population is there. And beaver community belongs to NT group, nomadic tribe. Then ST communities are there, like Gond, majorly Gond community is there. And then SC community is also there. And Kohlis and other agriculture communities, those came under the category of OBC in our area. And almost if we see a total demographic picture of a village, 65 to 70% of the population is belonging to SC, ST and NT category, and 30 to 35% population to OBC and other open caste groups. And definitely, they, as I have said, that the tanks are used for different purposes in village. And the scheduled tribe is also using different resources of tanks. Some of the grasses are used to prepare the brooms to clean the houses or the backyards and all that. And some of the grasses are used for thatching roof. Then there are some edible tubers in tanks which are used as food source. Then some of the edible vegetable plants also in these tanks, which are used by the all these categories, marginalized communities who belong very minimal land holding or the landless people also.
The next question is from Nima. Nima, are you there?
Yeah, now I'm there. Manishpa और Shalu, आप दोनों में से कोई भी जवाब दे सकते हैं. मुझे दो प्रश्न पूछना था. एक तो ये था कि अगर ये इनिशिएटिव को लैंडस्केप के लेवल पे ले जाना है तो इतने सारे टैंक्स में से आप 11 टैंक में काम कर.
Nima, you are muted. You are not audible.
I think she has dropped out. We'll move on. The next question.
But I have got what she was trying to ask.
No.
Okay.
So I will answer.
तो मुझे ये पूछना है कि या तो पॉलिसी लेवल पे कोई आपके काम से इंस्पायर होके सरकार ने कुछ कदम उठाया है या फिर आप लोगों ने ही एक फेडरेशन इन सब कम्युनिटीज थोड़ा लैंडस्केप के लेवल पे ये सब कम्युनिटीज इकट्ठा होने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं. एक ये प्रश्न था. दूसरा ये था कि अभी हम लोग कोविड के लॉकडाउन से निकले हैं सो उस सिचुएशन में किस तरह से इन्होंने उस क्राइसिस को हैंडल किया इसके बारे में अगर थोड़ा बता सकते हैं.
सोसाइटी के लोगों ने ऐसा किया कि उसके पास कोई तो पैसा नहीं था क्योंकि उतने अमीर नहीं है कि इतना कमा लेते वो तालाब के ऊपर रहते हैं तो इसलिए मासेमारी भी बीच में बंद हुई थी कोरोना के कारण थकित किया था. लेकिन अब कुछ मासेमार समाज ने सोसाइटी के लोगों ने पत्र लिखा कि हमको कुछ तो दिनों के लिए मछली मारने का काम करने दो इसलिए एक महीना यानी जून अप्रैल मई में उसने मासेमारी चालू किया था तो खाने को भी मिला और बेचने को भी नहीं मिला. मैंने अभी बताया था कि COVID-19 के बारे में भी उसने ये किया कि मासे मटन मछली तो मिल नहीं रही थी तो इसलिए सोसाइटी के लोगों ने इतना अच्छे किया कि वो मुल्की मच्छों का मुल्की मच्छे पकड़ कर बेचते थे लेकिन मार्केट तो जा नहीं सकते थे इसलिए उसने गांव में भी बेचा और वो एक मुल्की मच्छो अगर 250 किलो में होगी तो 300 किलो में बेचा क्योंकि रेट ज्यादा था और मिलते भी नहीं थे तो लोग इतने खाते थे इसलिए मासेमार समझो कि इतना अच्छा हुआ कि उसको रोजी मिली और अच्छा आमदनी भी हुई.
And definitely this situation has also impacted adversely also as markets were closed and there was no place to sell the fishes they found they have collected from these tanks. After as the lockdown process is going on and this is the season when they have to release the seeds of these IMCs. So they are facing problems in getting the quality seeds from traders situated in Chhattisgarh or West Bengal or Andhra due to these restrictions on transport and all that. Some of them have paid more prices for getting seeds, which were available cheaply earlier before this corona situation. And the other question you have asked about the landscape and policy. Some of the departments have contacted us locally from our area, the wildlife department, forest department, or social forestry department have also approached us to do the similar aquatic habitat restoration process in the tanks in forest area. Even the regular forest department have also contacted us for carrying out this activity in the buffer area tanks of Navegaon Nagzira Tiger Reserve, which are situated in the villages around forest area. But still, there are not very positive response from fishery department or any other department in this regard, that they are basically, they still, the fishery department is still sticked up with their model of aquaculture promotion. Even just 1 year before, the central government has released the guidelines for framing freshwater fishery policy of India to all the state governments. Earlier there is no fishery policy of India, though different states have them, but in Maharashtra there was no freshwater fishery policy. All the work from last 60 years in Maharashtra in the freshwater tanks is going on the basis of Marine Fishing Act, and only some they have derived some rules and regulations on the basis of provisions in the Marine Act, and still there is no act, Freshwater Fishery Act or policy in Maharashtra. And after we have done this exercise and got the experiences from villages and experiences of communities, we started ourselves contacting different traditional fishing communities in Maharashtra. And there are 9 communities in Maharashtra who are traditionally doing fishing. 4 of them are purely fishing communities in fresh waters, not in marine area. And three of them are PVTGs, primarily vulnerable tribal groups, and one is schedule, belongs to scheduled tribe. So we started contacting them and asking them, telling them experiences of our area and what was their experiences and how the things are going on in their areas and in their water bodies. But we started this sharing with the communities before 6 to 7 months, and just after one meeting, this all the communication and meetings and communication with these communities was stopped due to lockdown. But post lockdown, we are planning to have detailed dialogues with these communities and visit their areas, call some of them to our area, and we are trying to formulate the community's draft of freshwater fishery policy of Maharashtra.
Moving on, the next question is from Suhas Dai.
Hello, I'll speak in Marathi so Shalu enjoys and then Manish can translate the answer for others. Shalu, khup chan mandani keli. Mala vicharayche ki तुम्ही महिला इतकं काम करता तर सगळ्या गोष्टींचे हक्क नेहमी पुरुषांच्या नावावर असतात, तर तुमच्या महिला गटांना तुम्ही हक्क मिळवले आहेत का? मास्किंग इफ द विमेन्स ग्रुप्स हॅव डिमांडेड ऑर मेड सम एफर्ट्स टू गेट द एंटायटलमेंट्स फॉर देम, अदरवाइज ऑल द एंटायटलमेंट्स गो टू मेन ओनली. थँक्यू.
Manish, Shalu.
Suhastai, I was not able to hear your question because the laptop was out of electric current and I was struggling to get it back because the battery was...
I can out. Repeat.
Can you please repeat?
Yes. नेहमी कुठल्याही गोष्टींचे अधिकार फक्त पुरुषांना जातात, ट्रॅडिशनली पण आणि अदरवाइज पण. तर जसं आता या महिला इतकी कामं करतात, महिला गट आहेत, तर ते अधिकार त्यांना जावेत यासाठी काही प्रयत्न केले आहेत का आणि ते कुठवर आले? धन्यवाद.
नमस्ते सुहासताई.
बोल.
सब महिला ही करते हैं लेकिन उसका श्रेय पुरुषों को जाता है, इसलिए हमने अभी ये कर रहे हैं कि सहकारी सोसाइटी है तो सोसाइटी में महिलाओं को कैसे अधिकार और हक मिले, इसलिए हमने ये कोशिश चालू है कि सोसाइटी में 50% पुरुष और 50% महिला रहे, इसलिए हम महिलाओं के साथ बैठक उसके साथ बात करते हैं. और अब हमने मैं तभी थोड़ी देर में यही बता रही थी कि महिलाओं ने समाधान करके सदा अपनी एनिफेशन निकाला, लेकिन वो नाम पुरुषों का भी हुआ क्योंकि सोसाइटी को है तालाब, तो सब लोग बोलते कि सोसाइटी को लोगों ने निकाला लेकिन महिलाओं ने निकाला और पुरुषों का नाम हुआ. इसलिए हमने यही कोशिश है कि अभी महिलाओं को पुरुष काम करे और महिला का नाम हो, इसलिए ये अभी कोशिश जारी है कि महिला को 50% आरक्षण मिले और सोसाइटी में शेयर होल्डर हो जाए, ये कोशिश है अभी.
100% ग्यारह म्हणजे निदान 50% देतील, सहज देणारे नाही आहेत पुरुष कधी. 100% महिला सोसायटीने रजिस्टर करा. थँक्यू.
थँक्यू. नेक्स्ट इज अ क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम उल्हास गोरे. सम क्वेश्चन एंड कमेंट्स. If you could unmute your mic, please. No.
Maybe you can ask the question, Tanya.
No, he had some comments. Is there anybody else who has any questions?
I think he was asking whether you are in touch with Kiran Purandare.
Yeah.
For Nazira region, and are you working with him?
Yeah, he's just unmuted himself.
Yeah, we know each other, but I have met with him in Pune, not in my area. Though we have tried to establish contact because he wanted our help to do some restoration work in the tank of Pitesari, but still we are not able to communicate and go further.
Okay. Last year, anything else? Nivedita has a question.
Yes.
Yes.
Manish ji, मुझे दो सवाल पूछने हैं actually. एक मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ एनवायरनमेंट फॉरेस्ट एंड क्लाइमेट चेंज वालों ने पिछले साल वेटलैंड्स को लेके एक नेशन वाइड प्रोग्राम शुरू किया है. सो भंडारा एरिया या गोंदिया जिले के कोई वेटलैंड्स उसमें है, उसकी जानकारी आपको है क्या? आपके जो 12 तालाब है उनमें से कोई उसमें है क्या? ये एक चीज है. और दूसरा, भंडारा का कोई डॉक्यूमेंट मुझे भंडारा डिस्ट्रिक्ट की वेबसाइट पे मिला which says something about wetland conservation and management rules, और उसमें काफी सारा documentation जैसा दिखा है, तो उसमें आपकी भूमिका रही है क्या कोई?
Actually, Maharashtra State Biodiversity Board has done this work in Bhandara and Gondia, and in Bhandara, some of the people from our group was involved in preparing that document. But regarding to your earlier question, I have not heard of inclusion of any tank from our area in the program that you are mentioning.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, Ulas ji had a question about IPOMIA. I'm not able to locate the question. IPOMIA could also be used to add green litter to produce nursery mati as suggested by late Dabholkar of Prayog Parivar.
Used for what?
Nursery mati.
For improving soil protein values?
I think so. Yes.
I have not heard much of in this regard, but there are some organizations who were engaged in experimenting on producing electricity through the use these IPOMIA as biofuel, but that was also not very much possible. Locally, people used to use this IPOMIA in earlier days for compounds and compounds of their houses or kitchen gardens or agricultural fields, but when they have found that through this they are just propagating it in and introducing it to newer areas where it was not present naturally, so they stopped it. Then for some time it was used as fuel wood also, but women are complaining about it that the smoke of IPOMIA causes chest pain and cough due to it, and infection in eyes. So for using it as fuel wood by local community is stopped, and that's why currently there is no use of IPOMIA locally, and that's why we just eradicate it and during summer season. And as the Vidarbha is very hot region during summer, almost 45 to 47 degrees, it get dried up in 2 to 3 days and we just burn it.
Thank you, Manish. Thank you, Shalu. I think we will wrap up now because we are running out of time. So once again, thank you all for joining in. In the chat box, I've again put some of the links from where you can download more information, where if there's an email address, ICCA South Asia, if you want to join the e-list for CCAs in South Asia to know more about our upcoming webinars and as well as other things, please write to us. And that's all. Thank you so much for joining.